Good morning. And a very warm welcome to St. Martin's this morning. Whether you're with us here in the church or online, we welcome you to our worship this morning. Some intimations just before we start. Kirk Session meets on Wednesday at 7 p.m. The craft group meets tomorrow also at 7. We had a really good cinema night on Friday. I'm not sure when the July one is going to be because the first Friday in July I'm intending to be off, particularly because the day before is a general election. I'm usually here from 6 in the morning and then back at midnight. So I don't know when we'll do it, but the film in July is going to be Chariots of Fire. Oh, good. Good, that's much better than Odd Shings. The reason being that July this year is the 100th anniversary of Eric Liddell's famous victory, but also of his famous stand where he said that he wasn't going to race in the 100 metres, which was his best event, but he wasn't going to run because the heats were being held on a Sunday. So while they were running those races, he was preaching in the Scots Kirk in Paris. So I thought it was a good film. So we'll show it at some point in July, but I'm just not 100% sure of the date yet. Gladsmuir Church are doing their Sing at 6:30 events this year, and we joined in some of these last year. In fact, I sung at one of them. And they've been going for a couple of months, but there's one tonight, which is The Wonder of Watts, and it's all hymns from Isaac Watts. And if you're thinking, not got a clue, yes, you do. Most famously, And Can It Be That I Should Gain an Interest in the Saviour's Blood, the one that a friend of mine once said, it's a hymn that keeps threatening to stop but never delivers. So there's some leaflets with all the events that they're going to be having at 6:30 in this season of Sing at 6:30, and I would recommend them to you. As you know, this week saw the commemorations of the D-Day landings, and it was just amazing seeing these folk and me knowing. I don't know if my dad was there, but I know he was certainly at Arnhem because he was a paratrooper in the war. But like so many of these folk, never spoke about it. But their bravery just as incredible, and it gives us the right to stand and say the things that we do today because they fought for our freedoms. And so, you know, it's been wonderful to see these and realizing it's probably the last time at these commemorations that we'll see these old men who actually fought in that war. And so it's so important that we remember them. Today the Robin Chapel have a D-Day commemoration, and Nan and David are going. And I was joking when David came in this morning how suave and sophisticated you looked. And this is the suit that he bought to see the Queen a couple of years ago, but unfortunately, 3 or 4 years ago, but unfortunately, Monday, Thursday, it was cancelled because of COVID. So as I said to David, well, the Queen's loss is our gain. But Nan and David, please take to the Robin Chapel folks our best wishes for this afternoon and our prayers for what will be a very special event. They've got at least 3 consoles and a bishop going. The consoles will all be doing a Bible reading, and the French console will be reading in French. So it'll be a very memorable and a very important event, so please assure them of the prayers of St. Martin's. From the sublime to the maybe not that important, but to some of us it is. This week, St. Martin's purchased a TV licence. And you might be thinking, so? Well, basically it means if the Queen dies again, we won't show her funeral illegally this time. I thought we were covered, but we weren't. But also it means that we will be showing all 3 of Scotland's matches in the group stages of the European Championships. And in case you're thinking that's not important, we've actually had more responses to those posts on Facebook than to anything else we've ever done, and it's all been from women. So either we're going to get a lot of women coming, or they're just delighted that they can get their men out of the house. But if you want to come and see the football, then doors open on Friday for the Scotland-Germany game at 7:45. So 7:45, the game kicks off at 8 p.m. So come and see it on the big screen. We may even have pies and Bovril at halftime. One final announcement this morning, and again, as I said, I've had more reminders or more responses to Facebook about the football than anything else. I've had more reminders about a birthday today than I've ever had. And I think there's two reasons for this. One, the person in question is held in very high regard and with much love. But also, secondly, this is the person who grasses everybody else up when it's their birthday. And everybody wanted to make absolutely certain that we didn't miss hers. So today is Sandra's birthday. Sandra Darling. Happy birthday, Sandra. We hope you have an amazing day. But of course, because it's today. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Sandra. Happy birthday to you. Hip, hip. Hip, hip. Hip, hip. When I picked the hymns for this week, and Michael's preaching today, so it's going with his choice of reading. But when I picked him this morning, I didn't actually realise that a Wednesday was such a significant day. But it's interesting that God knows, even when we don't. And so you'll see some of the hymns today have not quite a military bearing, but you'll see what I mean. We're going to stand and sing the wonderful words of John Bunyan. Who would true valor see? Let him come hither. Let's stand, if we're able, and sing together. Be seated. Let's come before God in prayer. Let us all pray. he'll labour night and day to be a pilgrim. Gracious God, help us to labour night and day to follow in your footsteps. Help us to be pilgrims as we walk through our world, showing other people that we are Christians because of the love that we share. And Lord, assure us that you go with us and you protect us from everything that may come against us. Lord, we thank you for your love. For your love shown through Jesus Christ, who died on the cross that we might be forgiven, that we might be pilgrims and walk in your way. So Lord, in our worship this morning, call to us by your Holy Spirit, that we may indeed rise up and follow you, that we may walk in your way, that we may break down walls that divide and build your kingdom. Forgive us when we don't do that. Forgive us when we turn away from you. Forgive us when we go back to our old ways. But Lord, reassure us that when we turn back, you are there with your arms open wide. Lord, be with us in our worship this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. And as a family, we pray in our own languages and traditions the words that he taught us to say. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now we're going to sing a hymn that we haven't sung for a while. We have sung it before. It's from Robin Mark, and it's called There Is a Place of Commanded Blessing. And the chorus goes, we will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls. In the name of your Son, I'll turn them on in a minute, Nan. We will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, and we will be one. So if you know nothing else, just sing that bit. All right? And if you're singing to him, you're thinking, why are we singing this? Wait till you get to the reading, then you'll know. Okay, so if we're able, we stand and sing. There is a place of commanded blessing.
There is a place of commanded blessing where brethren in unity dwell. Place where anointed oil is flowing, where we live as one.
You called us.
You have called us to be a body. You have called us as friends, joined together in the bond of the Spirit unto the end. Father, we join you are, so let us be one, joined together in unity and purpose, all for the love of your Son. We will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, in the name of your Son. We will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, we dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, in the name of your Son. We will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, we will be one. But there is a place of commanded blessing, brethren in unity dwell. A place where anointed oil is flowing, and we live as one. You have called us to be a body. You have called us as friends. Joined together in the bond of your spirit. So let us be one, joined together in unity and purpose, all for the love of your Son. We will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, in the name of your Son. We will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls.
Between the east and the west, those walls, they're coming down. Between the black and the white, and the orange and the green, those walls, they're coming down.
We will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, in the name of your Son. We will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls.
And sons, between the brothers and sisters, those walls, they're coming down. Between the young and the old, and traditions grown cold, those walls, they're coming down.
We will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, in the name of your Son. We will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, we will be one. We will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, in the name of your Son. We will break dividing walls, we will break dividing walls, we will be one.
Well done. Our reading this morning is from Mark chapter 3 and will be read by Sandra Lowe.
Reading from the book of Mark chapter 3, verses 20 to 35. Then Jesus entered the house, and again a crowd gathered, so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. When his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, "He is out of his mind." And the teachers of the law who came down from Jerusalem said, "He is possessed by Beelzebub, by the prince of demons. He is driving out demons." So Jesus called them and spoke to them in parables. "How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. In fact, no one can enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man. Then he can rob his house. I tell you the truth. All the sins and blasphemies of men will be forgiven them, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. He is guilty of an eternal sin." He said this because they were saying, "He has an evil spirit." Then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived. Standing outside, they sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they told him, "Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you." "Who are my mother and my brothers?" he asked. Then he looked at those seated in a circle round him and said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whatever does God's will is my brother and sister and my mother." Amen, and thanks be to God.
Thank you, Sandra. I have to say there are some readings, like last week, when it's your turn to preach and you think, "Oh, yes." And there's some readings where it's Michael's turn to preach and you go, "Oh, yes." But I'm sure it'll be amazing. Just before Michael comes up to bring God's word to us this morning, we're going to sing. I love this hymn. We don't sing it very often, but we're going to sing it this week. And we sing, stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross.
Speak to us, Lord, by your Spirit, and let the word of God empower us to live for you in this world. Amen. don't mind my glasses. Broken. Thank you for joining in today's service, both online and in person. And thank you, Bill, once more for the privilege. Today, I have an assignment to share from Mark chapter 3, 20 to 25. A text that conveys a great deal of lessons. And as I was preparing this, sincerely, I struggled because it had deep things for us. But thanks to God, we are here today to share together. Just relax your mind, open your ears very wide so you could hear him. I'm from a family of seven. My father was a blacksmith. And usually, as the third son, I will always be with him in his workshop. At the course of our conversation one day, he said three things that I want to share with us. And he made those statements to remind me that in this world, there is something that is very important, or there are things that are much more important. The first thing he said was, "Son, good name is better than silver or gold." By that, I have to ensure in all I do that I remember I have a family's name to protect. And the second one, he said, any man or woman who is healthy is the richest person on earth. By that, he was telling me that a healthy life is more important than all you can imagine you have or you can possess on earth. And then finally, he said, son, never you overlook your family. Do not overlook your family. Today, we have a text that shows Jesus' family. A text that tells us about Jesus and his family. And we also see here Jesus' own concept or idea about family. As we go through this, I hope we'll be able to unravel what Jesus sees as family. From chapter 3, from verse 1 down, before we get to verse 20, Jesus has been casting out demons, healing diseases, performing miracles, and teaching the word of God, and a great crowd of people were following him. In fact, the Bible says, while he was preaching at the seashore of Galilee, the crowd was so much that he needed to get into a boat. And he preached from the boat and performed so many wonders, healed the sick, and many things that happened. Verse 20 then records that he went back home. Jesus went back to his house. Let's use that. When he got home, ordinarily he was tired. He should at least get something to eat. But the news of his arrival or his coming home attracted a greater crowd of people than he had before. And this time around, these were people who had situations, people who had needs, people who were concerned. They wanted to hear him speak. And Jesus, with his disciples, did not go into eating. Instead, he started preaching again, teaching again, performing miracles again and again. The news of his return got to his own family, Mary, the mother, his brothers and sisters. Sadly, the father was not mentioned. I don't know why. Could it be that he was dead by then? I don't know. But this, his family came when they heard the news that he had gone back home. They got up, rushed to get to him. Why? They heard something about Jesus. Mary, the mother, and the siblings had heard that Jesus was casting out demons with the powers of Satan. They heard that this young man who was carrying the image of the family out there is doing something that is denting the family's name. And they said, no, this young man is crazy. Let's go get him and bring him back to his senses. So they all moved out to get Jesus. But when they got there, they saw a crowd. The crowd was so much that they could not get access to Jesus. So they had to send an information and say, tell him that we are here for him. Well, while they were outside there, a crowd was inside with Jesus. And when Jesus heard that his mother and brothers and sisters were outside waiting to have him, he responded, looking around, he responded to those who brought the message and said, who then are my brothers, my mother, and my sisters? He pointed to the people who were needy, the people who were sick, the people who were desiring to know more about God, and said, these ones, they are my mother, my brothers, and my sisters. There's a great lesson to learn from that statement. Jesus was at this moment redefining family. I was pondering over this and something came into my mind, and that was an egg, a boiled egg. It could be a raw egg, but let me use the boiled egg. The egg has a yellow part. It has three parts. The yellow part, which is the egg yolk. When I was younger, my father would always tell us that that particular part of the egg is meant for the children. I don't know how true that is. And then you have the outer one that is whitish in color. And that's what the adults eat. That's what my daddy said. And then you have the shell that keeps the egg. These three parts of the egg came into my mind as I was pondering over the family based on Jesus' redefinition of family. The yellow is the immediate family where that includes yourself, your husband, your wife, your children if you're married, yourself, your father, your mother if you're not married, yourself, your siblings, and those who are immediate with you. And then you have the white one, which is larger and bigger. And within Jesus' context, he is saying that those people who come to him, who are seeking him, who are interested in getting the benevolence of God, they are the outer family. They are the ones that, the larger family rather. In other words, those who have accepted Jesus in their lives as their Lord and personal Savior, they are also a family. St. Martin's is a family because we are made up of people from different yellow family, that's the middle family, coming together to form the white family, the pure family of Christ, all right?
And we are all covered with a bigger shell, which is stronger than the white egg color and the yellow one. All right? And that shell is the love of Christ. That is what is binding us together. So whether you're from the little family, the nucleus, or you are from the bigger one, the white one, we are all covered in the love of Christ. And that keeps us strong. Can you do something for me now? Sorry. But please do it for me. Turn to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, I love you. No. Are you doing that? Let me remove my glasses. Please turn to your neighbor. That your neighbor may be your wife, may be your brother, may be your sister, may be your friend. But just turn to the person and say, I love you. Thank you. Thank you for saying that. I love you too. That's why we are family. As a family, we love each other. As a family, we are covered by the love of Christ. As a family, we are sustained by the love of Christ. It is only the love of Christ that can keep us together. And that's why I enjoyed the two hymns that we have just taken. They all talk about us being one in him, about us becoming united and bonded in the love of Christ. However, in this context, we saw another group of people known as the Pharisees, the scribes. They came not to hear the word of God, but to accuse Jesus. They accused him of using the power of Satan to perform his wonders. And that's very shocking to hear. These were religious people. They should have done better than others. But they were the ones fighting Jesus. They were the ones building a wall between Jesus and what God has brought him to do in the lives of the people of Israel. And the song we sang last says, we will break the wall. So Jesus broke the wall by telling them, Satan cannot fight against Satan. Any kingdom that rises against each other will fall. In our physics class, while I was in school, we were taught that North Pole and South Pole attract, but North Pole and North Pole repels, that is magnet. So if you bring a magnet and you bring the north side and the north side together, they will push themselves away. So kingdom cannot fight itself. No. But when you bring the south part of magnet and the northern part of it together, it will attract. It will fight. And sometimes it will emit some energy. Even in electricity, when you bring negative and positive, there will be a spark. In this context, Jesus is reminding us that as a family, we should not fight ourselves. It is not right. But we saw Mary, the brothers of Jesus and the sisters of Jesus, coming because their concern was to protect the family's name. They said, no, you are crazy. You can't be doing this. They did not understand the divine agenda of God that Jesus was sent to fulfill. And in our time, we also see people in the same situation. We tend to protect more our immediate family than the family of Christ. While we fight to protect our immediate family, which is very important, let us also look out for the family of Christ. Remember that as you go home today, kingdom that fights itself can never stand. Finally, there are a few things I want you to note. Number one, our families, from Jesus' redefinition of family, our families
extend beyond blood relation. I'm a Nigerian. Some of you, okay, someone told me she's from England. Some of you are English, some are Scots, some are Germany, either Uganda or anywhere, from different places, different background. Yet, we are here. And that shows that the family we belong to now extends and supersedes the family we came from. Let's hold this understanding. It will help us to keep striving more for greater success ahead. Number two, there is always discipleship challenge. Following Jesus leads us away from some special recognized norms, some of the things that society approves and supports. Following Jesus will definitely move us away from most of them, not all of them. And we need to understand that. It is Christ's nature to make us look like Christ. It is his nature, is his will, his plan and purpose is to make everyone in his family look like him. And I cannot look like him, you cannot look like him, if we don't move away from whatever is not accepted in his presence. So there is that discipleship challenge. We always struggle to make sure that we balance our societal norms with the Christian norm. And if anyone is going contrary to the Christian principle, you are expected as a member of that bigger family to do your best to follow the pattern of the bigger family. And then lastly, we need to recognize the Holy Spirit at work in this bigger family. Let us always discern that the Spirit of God is working amongst us and within us. And when we do that, we will be able to avoid the same problem that the Pharisees and the scribes had by accusing Jesus that he was doing what he was doing or performing miracles by the power of Satan. They were committing a grave sin, an unforgivable sin. That's the sin of blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. It's so terrible. So, because we belong to this bigger family, let us always recognize the presence of the Holy Spirit in this bigger family. And the Holy Spirit can do anything he wants in this bigger family. He can use anybody. He can use you, use me, use anybody to do whatever he wants to do, to say whatever he wants to say in the bigger family which we belong to. In the history of Israel, I'm closing with this. There was a time in 1 Samuel chapter 8. Samuel was in between opinions. He didn't know what way to follow, what to do, because his children, who were supposed to represent the family's good name, had messed the family name. They had gone their way out, doing things that were not accepted as children of a priest, who incidentally were to take over from the father. And in Samuel's heart, he wants his children to take after him or to replace him if he's gone. The people of Israel themselves, knowing that the family has been dented, decided that they should have a bigger family. And having a bigger family in this case means looking outward, how are people out there doing it? And they said, people out there are succeeding because they have physical kings. Therefore, Samuel, give us a king we can see. And when Samuel heard it, it grieved his heart. Family fighting against itself. God heard that and said to Samuel, don't be angry about what they've requested for. They did not reject you, they rejected me. Give them a king. And he gave them King Saul. You know the story very well. And you know how it ended with Israel.
people of God, as we pray together, as we ponder over this together, and as we journey in Christ together, let us always have this at the back of our mind. We are God's family. We are friends in Christ. I'm always humbled anytime Bill says to me, "Well done, my friend." I say, well, that's who we are. May God bless us the more as we walk in the path of love and in this bigger family. Amen. We'll take our offering as we sing together, sitting down. God sent his son. Because he lives, okay.
God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives.
Let's pray. Father, we give thanks to you the giver of all things. You gave your only begotten Son to die for our sake. And from our resources and our time and life, we have given to you. Accept our gift, that it will be an accepted offering, which you, O Lord, will be pleased with. We come to you, bringing our nation unto you, because you are God who rules over all things. Our country is in your hands as we march towards the next general election. We pray for your wisdom and for your choice. Build this nation stronger in your grace and your love, and let all things work together for good, for we love you. We bring before you, O Lord, our God, those who are going through some difficult moments, because you are the Lord that heals. And today we saw from the gospel how you heal the sick, how you cast out demons. We are trusting you again and again, even now, for the healing and deliverance by your Spirit of those who are going through some health challenges, difficult moments, those who can't sleep at night, those who have trouble and restless days, those who are undergoing a difficult health challenge with no hope of cure, those who are living, managing their own health situations. Lord Jesus, you healed in your time. In our own days, you are still healing. Therefore, we pray this morning that by your Spirit, you will grant good health to the sick, both those among us and those within our parish bound, and those listening to us or watching online, or anyone whom we are related to in any way, and those whom we could name in the silence of our heart. May the balm of Gilead reach out and soothe the wounds of your people. Thank you for your healing grace, for we are assured in our heart that you have healed. Glorify your name forever, O Lord. For we have prayed through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. The last hymn is Trust and Obey. And please, if you're able, just stand as we sing.
Stand up.
as we go back home, and as we engage in the world, may we never forget the love that is binding us together. Go in peace. The grace of the Lord Jesus continue to be with you and with all your loved ones, now and evermore. Amen. Please be seated.